To this computer. There we go. Welcome everybody and our listening audience too. If you're listening to this on the YouTube channel, welcome to our implementation and overview lab on the theme of integrity for January. So we always do this implementation lab for the next month's theme. And sometimes people have read the packet. I think more often than not, people are like, oh, I haven't read it. Just tell me about it. And so for those of you who are auditory learners, welcome. So the first part of this little show is me telling about the overview. So when I wrote it, what lenses was I thinking about? What are some of the highlights? And then I have a few little show and tell things here too. And then we'll go into a shared format where we do challenges we're facing, opportunities we're facing, and then takeaways and solutions that we can offer each other. Hi, welcome. And it's good to see you all here. It really is. So this is the overview part. But first, we have a few announcements. One is the next Brainstorm Lab will not be January 1st, which is the first Wednesday of the month. And it has yet to be decided because Thursdays have a few problems and complications. So I'll announce it. And in addition, I'm going to bump the implementation lab for January to another day as well because I have to be traveling on Wednesday. And I thought it wouldn't be so cool to do this in an airport somewhere. Yeah. So here we go. Integrity, the overview. We came up with four buckets. Walking the talk, so that's the social justice bucket. Finding deep joy, that's the connection to your inner self when you practice that with integrity and you find your inner self. The integrity of the we, so that's the integrity of the group. It might be covenant making. It might be the things that you do together as a community, the integrity of the we. And then the last of the four is finding the courage to be yourself. So integrity, for in my mind, takes the theme of the traditional theme of New Year's, New Month, which is we make a resolution, and takes it one step deeper. In that, what is our truest self saying that we should do? And that's once again why I like thematic ministry. So it's not just, hey, you made a resolution, what was it? And I think I've mentioned before, but you may not know, that January 10th is Break Your Resolution Day because they found out that in about 10 days, most people are just like throwing this out the window. And yet, if you go into your integrity of your deepest, truest self, I think that will be easier to keep as a goal in your month of January. So there's a few things in those four buckets that I wanted to highlight. One is the book, the sort of quintessential book for integrity for me right now is The Empty Pot. Very popular book. Very accessible because not only do you have to, if you don't have this, it's on Tapestry of Faith and Creating Home as an online story. And, you know, the idea, here's Ping, the idea that he alone had a pot with nothing growing in it. And yet wasn't that what the emperor was looking for? He was looking for the child who would follow their integrity because he gave them seeds that were boiled. Sort of a sly guy, if you ask me. There's a lizard song story, which I suggested for all ages. And this is such a sweet song story. It's got a song with this little lizard. And I had iguanas. We owned one iguana, pet iguana, that was as long as my arm, and then his tail would come up around our neck when I was with my two sons growing up. I can just picture that as part of a for all ages. Get somebody with an iguana to come in and hold their iguana while you tell this lizard song. And then the song, there is no tune offered. So I thought I'd offer you the tune I sing with it. And it's a minor tune. Let's see if I can find it in my brain. It's the tune I imagine a lizard in the desert southwest singing. Zoli, 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 zoli. Zoli, 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 zoli. Rock is my home. I mean, I just made it up. And the story is that this bear comes up and said, oh, that's such a nice song. And the lizard said, but that's my song. And the bear says, she says, I want to learn it too. So she goes off and she starts singing, Zoli, Zoli, Zoli. And she can't remember the rest of it. So she runs back to Lizard and says, what's that song again? Zoli, Zoli, Zoli. And they're singing it again. And the third time that bear comes back and she asks, she says to the lizard, what's wrong with me? I can't remember it. And the lizard said, it's because rock is not your home. Den is your true home. And it's just so perfect for integrity. And I find it very accessible. And so the bear goes off singing, Zoli, 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 den is my home. And of course she remembers it because it's her integrity. So that's the little lizard song. Here's two things. One is we put the 30 days of love in there. That starts in January and it goes through February 14th, love. At this time, even now, the website is not updated. So I'm keeping my fingers crossed that the 30 days of love folks will update it, but I'm not sure that they will be offering that. So I'll give you guys a heads up and hopefully it'll be there. The second fun thing is, as my family will tell you, I'm always about who was you, you know, anytime there's a book that comes out, oh, she was a you, oh, he was a you. And yet here's an example for January. It's Millard Fillmore's birthday in January. He was the 13th president of the United States. And he was also the signer of the Fugitive Slave Act, which meant that a slave owner could send people up to catch their slaves that had escaped to the North and bring them back. It was a fairly horrific piece of legislature. And there's two interpretations. So if you read the UU biography interpretation, here's a man who was trying to keep his integrity by not starting a war because of the South succeeding if anything was anti-slavery was done. And so he had to choose between war and slavery. But the more modern things, there's a great Huffington Post article that I've referenced that talks about how he pretty much allied himself with rabid bigots. And he was a rabid bigot as well. And in this current climate of our politics, I think it's good to understand that not all you use get to practice integrity. And it's a subtle theme, and yet I think for the youth it would be really appropriate to use an example of where we need to think about what integrity means. Millard Fillmore, 13th president of the United States. Oh yes, and the other neat thing, January of course is Martin Luther King 3-day weekend. And Martin Luther King was invited to be the 1966 Ware Lecturer at the UUA General Assembly. And I just find that really heartwarming. And he gave this talk, this was 2 years before he was assassinated, to UU saying, you people, I'm really glad to be here. I just wish I had been there. And then in the same paragraph that I've referenced why MLK could have never been a UU and what the differences were between the Black church tradition and UUism in terms of intellectualism of UU, not really bringing the survival, the faith, the love that was needed to march, to sacrifice, and to do all this. So you read that article, I think you'll find it interesting. And okay, so here's another thing. Oh, the book A is for Activist by Inocente Nogueira. Very good book. And Regina's nodding her head, yes. And here's the thing. When I suggest it for preschoolers, I'm reading it as a book about the gestalt of social justice for preschoolers, you know, because there's huge words. What four-year-old do you know uses the word activists? I don't know very many. And, oh, yes, good. Okay, Regina's proving me wrong. And yet we want them to hear these words. We want them to feel the feeling of pride and involvement. And there's a video there of him reading it to his preschooler. So you can really get a sense of how he's written that book. And there's a reason why I suggest it for this, the same book, A is for Activists, for the first through fifth graders, because they're going to start capturing some more of those larger concepts. So I find it's one of those books that's gestalt for preschool, the atmosphere, and the actual alphabet activism for the older children. So I didn't want anybody to feel like I picked a book that was really too young for the elementary school children. That's my reason anyway. Also, there's the underlying theme for the first through fifth grade in one of the sessions, which is, I think it's the conscience one is the finding deep joy, which would be number two. And I hope this picks up. But I use a music box as the wonder element. Now, this is the music box I use for youth, too. So when you play it, and I don't know if this will even pick up, but you can hardly hear it. Can you hear it at all? Yeah, maybe. It's just, and you see when you add, and this is the moral of the story, when you add a board, any kind of board. Now, usually I set it on a table, but I can't because it would disappear from your view. But this board works just as well. You add a resonating board, and it's really loud. Okay, so the moral of the story is when you add a group of supportive people, your own conscience, your own integrity is extra, extra loud. And I recommend a little music box like this. They're often in little arts and crafts stores and things like that, just to illustrate that. That's one of my shows and tells. The other thing I do about integrity is about standing tall. And I use some tree metaphors for that. There's some books, Standing Tall, Molly Lou Mellon, and those kinds of things. But I think that's another accessible way to investigate integrity, is that idea of standing tall. Well, that's what I have for the overview of the lab. I mean, of the packet, the integrity packet. So now what I invite us to do is, I think I've shown this before, but I wanted to show you the book that I reference quite a bit, Doorways to the Soul, it's Wisdom Tales. And I can't include these stories in the packet, but I reference it often enough that you'll want to buy Doorways to the Soul if you can. 52 Wisdom Tales from Around the World by Elisa Davy Pierman. She is a UU. So this is like the modern version of Sophie Faz's Long Ago and Many Lands. Or maybe not a modern version, maybe just a nice collection. And she's got really great ideas for sharing the story with others, trying on the idea of the stories, and making a personal connection with the story, as well as these stories. Okay, with that little thing, Ed, I would like to invite us to talk about our challenges. And this is when we do a time. There's a few of us, so let's do a minute and a half. And would someone like to just hold their phone up to the camera when it's time for someone to be done? Thank you, Sam. All right. And I'll just start with Fran, if you'd like to go, Fran. I'm going to start at the bottom of my screen. And this is about challenges that you're facing. And as you know, this is as open as it can be. It might be challenges for this month of December. It might be challenges for next month of January. It might be finding something, whatever's in your brain right now.
I'm wondering, can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, good. My challenge is that I just had surgery and will have another surgery coming up in a month. Mm-hmm. And this time it's planned rather than unexpected. And it seemed like I did really well because it was unexpected. I was pretty much in a state of open acceptance and not being fearful. And I think there's something that has to do with integrity and being fearful. I'm not exactly sure. It's almost like I'm getting this picture in my mind about we're all in a hero's journey, and how does the journey help mold me? And I'm always interested in finding the, like all of the themes that we have every single month. They're just beautiful. That's all you really, I want a recipe book of all those themes. So how can I be in awe instead of fear? How can I be? And I said this to the surgeon that I talked to. I looked at her in the eyes just really deeply in my heart and feel this truthfully. I said, I know that you don't walk on water, and I feel that you kind of do. There's something that I have an innate trust with you, and I recognize what's supposed to happen and what possibly could go wrong. But that's true any day, every day. It's not just one day in the life of anybody. And so I'm wanting to embrace the brilliance about life, just plain life. What's it offering me every day? Mm-hmm. And I'm in awe of the challenge that I have, and I thank you.
Thank you, Fran, and many blessings on this journey for you. Thank you. Thank you, Susan. Next on my screen is Regina.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Challenges. I'm struggling to find, especially in December, a balance between my life as a RE lady and my life as a mom of small children, and trying to create some holiday magic for them here as well. And I'm struggling with not having an RE committee to support me in my congregation. I feel like I'm doing everything myself, and even farming out small portfolios to volunteers is taking a lot of time and effort. I'm really struggling with, like, you're starting to plan January now, but I'm using all of my time to make December happen. And so I feel like I'm 5 steps behind all the time. It's very stressful.
Yeah.
Sorry. Kind of overwhelmed this morning. This is very difficult because my congregation expects me to have programming for the children every single Sunday. And I just, it's a lot. It's a lot. And I'm quarter time.
Yeah. And I hope you've seen the chat. We're all holding you in our hearts. And I remember from last time how much you were describing was going to be coming up this month. So, and I think everyone understands totally what you're going through. Every DRE does. Yes, we hold you in our hearts.
Thanks. Sorry.
Yes.
I'm going to grab a cup of coffee real quick.
Yeah.
I'll be right back.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Poof. Next in my list from the bottom up is Karina. Oh, Karina. It says you're unmuted, but I don't hear you. Why don't you fiddle and we'll go to Sam. Great. And Sam, I'll do the...
Thanks, Katie. Mm-hmm. Right now, my challenge is a numbers imbalance with teachers versus particular age groups. Between my two elementary classes, I am down a few teachers between travel and personal life, and don't tell anyone, but one of my teachers is Santa Claus, so he's kind of busy right now. And our middle school class, we have enough teachers, but because we're doing coming of age right now and some of our youth are in there, that class has shrunk considerably. So we've been having to pair up and pair off with our classes. And I wanna say it's going well at the moment, but it's, I feel like I'm having to punt every Sunday morning, like 15 minutes before our first service, and making sure everyone is squared up and where do I need to be. And breathing through it all. And when I get an opportunity, I'll ask one of the kids, like, hey, how do you think class is going? And some are enjoying it and some are a little frustrated, and trying to balance that out. And it's, we've had luck in the past doing like one room schoolhouse type of arrangements. And this time around, it's a little tougher than usual.
Mm-hmm. All right, punting and breathing there too. There's a question from Fran. Tell you what, that's a good question for when we do our takeaways and our let's keep that in mind, takeaways and solutions for each other. Yes, so here we are in the crazy month. Just about every facet of the groups of people I'm dealing with right now are in stress. Most of them are religious educators or ministers, but it is a very incredible time. We think we have to create the holiday magic for everybody and everything, isn't it? And it's just hard. I think Sam has captured it with breathing and punting. You know, so fortunately we know that there is nothing new to the high stress on staff of the church in almost any Christian denomination or Christian based. This is a crazy time. I know, for instance, Mia in Albuquerque, she has something like 5 Christmas Eve services to run and things like that. So we do whatever we can do, don't we? And then we let go of the rest. Let's take a deep breath together, whew, and move into the opportunities that December provides us with. One thing that I know is that our staff at the Boulder Valley Church, the congregation I served before I worked for Soul Matters, we just would postpone the staff meeting until January, because we were just too busy, and it wouldn't have been enjoyable to have yet one more thing to do. So as you're thinking about opportunities that the theme of integrity or this month or whatever is in your brain, for what opportunities exist for you this month and next. And let's start with Fran again.
My time in the hospital put me in touch with a lot of really beautiful people. One of them was a physical therapist, and she says, not my race, not my pace.
Mm.
So that was something that really helped me. And she said, okay, you got to get out of bed and you got to walk. And so she said, look at the ceiling. You know, see those tiles? Count them. You know, 200. I want you to go 200 one way and 200 the other. So it was very measurable. And I'm not very good at measuring because I'm very global, I'm very random, I'm very free-flowing, and I don't know boundaries very well. However, that little tiny lesson, I felt like, well, that's why I am in the hospital. I'm only here for this one reason. Not my race, not my pace. So even when you say that we're in this crazy time, I want to not affirm that. If you want to affirm that, you can. Because of my special situation that I'm in, I feel like my body is mandatory that I am in bed at 6, and I'm kind of enjoying it. I'm having my soup, I have my readings, I'm in bed, maybe I go to sleep at 8, but I am usually not out anymore at night right now. Of course, I'm a jitterbug and I want to do everything, but I'm also just recognizing that physical therapist, not my race, not, and just because other people are having that doesn't mean I have to buy in. So that's it.
Awesome. Thank you, Fran. I love that little one. Little, was it aphorism? Wisdom from a PT. Regina, are you up for some opportunities?
I am. I'm going to be honest, I haven't had the opportunity to look at the January packet yet.
Right.
But I am embracing awe so much. And I've been telling working on my storytelling and enjoying the opportunity to reorder the lessons so that they would fit the flow of our congregational life.
Mm.
And this weekend I have the opportunity to run the MC the no practice Christmas pageant. I'm really excited about that. Mm. Hopefully I haven't invested too much of my own vision. You know, hopefully I'm going to embrace, I need to be aware that I will also have the opportunity to see it as a success, even if it doesn't match my own sort of theatrical production vision that I had for it when I picked the music, which includes a song by Coldplay. We're doing a star full of, your sky full of stars as the introit for the, and then Can You Feel the Love Tonight will feature as two choir pieces.
Oh, nice. Oh, I want to be there. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Regina. Karina, any luck with your mic? Darn. Oh, and you always have good things to say to us. You know, go down to your left-hand screen where it says mute. And if you do the drop-down arrow, there's a whole bunch of select your microphone. Why don't you try selecting or testing and see if you can get something that sounds like something. And while you do that, we'll move to Sam.
Opportunities. So amidst all the December chaos, we typically do two services a Sunday, and for December, for various reasons, we decided to go to one service. And then to supplement the one service, we've been offering community activities. You know, decorating a candle for solstice and making your own mistletoe, cookie decorating. And it's been really well received in that people are happy to have community. It's such a stressful time of year. Not everyone enjoys the holidays. Mm-hmm. Not everyone has family to go to over the holidays. And to offer a space that you can be comfortable, you can be welcome, you can get your spirit fed, you can have a laugh and share a hug and find ways to, you know, little ways to enjoy the holiday. I've been getting comments from all generations that they're really enjoying this. And I've been wanting people to meet someone that they've never met before and, you know, learn a name and go, you know, I know your face, you know, let's spend 2 minutes chatting. And I love it. I love it. And so does everyone else. It's been a wonderful month for community.
Oh, wonderful. And I'm going to take just a break. Well, don't mute yourself because we had a request on the chat box for more details on mistletoe.
Oh, make your own mistletoe. The wonders of Google had helped me with this. And I found, if I can find the link, I'll share it before we're done. But it's made out of felt. So it comes with a template, or you can draw your own on different shades of green. You cut them out. You use red embroidery floss. I got the thicker floss. And you create a loop and you wrap it around the stem portion of your mistletoe. And then use a couple of wood beads or white beads or whatever you want to find to loop it on so you have your berries. Okay. And tie it off, and it can last a long time. It's not going to fall apart, and you still have mistletoe. Mm-hmm. So it's they came out just adorable. It was fun.
And Fran had a little piece of interest too. She's asking, what did you call that session, I think? Was it regular RE? It wasn't regular RE.
It wasn't during regular RE. It was offered after service when we would have our regular coffee time. And we have a table set on one side of Fellowship Hall or outside if weather is permitting that everyone can come and go to. And early November, I had sent out a call to certain volunteers asking, hey, can you sign up to help lead this table? Mm-hmm. And it totally worked. We had several people sign up and said, oh yeah, I can do this Sunday. I want to help decorate cookies. I want to make a snowflake. The way it came together was wonderful, but we did it during coffee hour. So mm-hmm. Everyone can come and go.
Mm. Awesome. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Us DREs are applied people. We like to know the details. I'm glad you both asked for more details. There's Karina. Karina, any luck? Try. No. Oh, I wonder what's going on. Well, we love to see your happy face. So And you can chat all you want in the chat box too. We'll pay attention to that. With the sound. Okay. And there's a make your own. Yes. Yep. And we're in the chat box for our listening audience that can't see. There's a lot of people saying all the things they've done. Make a Christmas tree ornament, says Regina, as a craft station. And when I was growing up at Mainline Unitarian Church in Devon, Pennsylvania, we had a make your own gift Sunday afternoon thing. And I miss it so much that I'm going to take 3 gifts to my grandchildren on Christmas Day from that program just so we can do them together. And that's when we made half shell walnut candles, pour a little candle wax in. It was all stuff you could make in an afternoon. And those are just lovely, lovely memories. The first year I told the congregation that I had done this as a child, would anyone like to help me? And no one responded. So I said, well, we're not going to do it, because I was not interested in running this big thing. It was for a fairly large congregation. And then after December holidays, some people said, well, how come that was canceled? We were going to look forward to it. And those 4 people who contacted me then became the directors of it. So I could come and just do my little table of whatever thing I wanted to teach. And they were the big directors. So it's fun. All right. And there's chalice noisemakers for New Year's, stars of joy, heart, and decorated peace signs. Yeah, all kinds of great stuff is going on for our faith communities to celebrate together. Last bit is takeaways. Now that you've seen these things we're chatting about and you've heard these things, what solutions and takeaways are you thinking about for this month and next? I think we're sort of in the present moment in this lab today. This December is taking it over. So I'm glad I did the overview. You can rewatch it when the holidays are over and get a sense. But I'm also glad that we're sharing what's happening right now in the present. And just another thing that would happen in January is we made sure we really, really reduced the programming in January so the staff could have a slow month. You know, just no big special things because of the exhaustion of this month. I mean, in my church, I alone did 7 extra services, you know, 7 total instead of 4. Because of winter solstice, Christmas Eve, we had 3. Oh, it's just endless. Oh, yeah, there's a dance party on New Year's Eve. Yeah. Okay, takeaways. And we'll start with, and tell you what, Karina, if you want to do your takeaway in the chat box, I'll share it with other folks. And we'll let Fran start like we did before.
My takeaway is something that you just said, that you gave an idea and nobody stepped forward. And then people said, gee, I really wanted to do it. Well, therein lies the rub. That is the key. I've just heard that they want to hire somebody 1/4 time to find out how they can get more people to volunteer for more things in the congregation. And I'm still new. This is a year. I'm barely in my year. And what I noticed is that when people want to volunteer, sometimes the people that are in charge and that are seniors have so much energy that they don't make any room for anybody else to participate. And it sounds to me, I've heard it 3 times, very demeaning. I'm so happy that you're here. This is a very famous artist in the community. Would you just come in and take inventory of all the art supplies? I'm thinking, really? That it's not comparable. It's not. It doesn't mean that that doesn't need to get done. But I'm trying to find out what my takeaway is that how can I become more attuned to what people will actually show up and do and help them cultivate? How can I draw it out rather than say, oh, well, they're not going to do it, I'll do it myself. Or I'm going to, you know, or get somebody out from outside of the community to come in and help me. Mm-hmm. I think that I want to find a way to listen more deeply, maybe with more awesomeness. What does somebody really want that they'll actually do? They'll roll up their sleeves and actually do.
Yep. We are often volunteer coordinators more than religious educators, aren't we? Okay, right. Thanks. Yes. Thanks, Fran. And Regina, takeaways and solutions.
My biggest takeaway is that I feel very affirmed and validated in my tentative plan to declare the first Sunday in January a board game day, NRE, even though that has nothing, very little perhaps to do with the theme, but it has very much to do with my own personal integrity.
Exactly. Awesome.
And that I have a wonderful community of supportive colleagues. And that it's okay to get caught up in the awe, right? I mean, like, just this chat is amazing. All these wonderful holiday ideas and this joy that we're making right now in our communities is real, and it's okay. It's okay to still be even in that, even though January is only 2 weeks away. Awesome. We can take that first week of January off to regroup.
Yeah.
Okay to do that.
Awesome. Thank you, Regina. I'm going to read Karina's chat. She says, I think Fran asked about DRE's teaching. I do sub for teachers occasionally, but I try to be clear that it's not a habit. I lead children's chapel once a month to give teachers a break, and I lead summer one-room schoolhouse with different volunteers, so teachers are off during the summer. Yes, that's so wise to say, for this one time, I would be glad to sub for you since it's too late for you to get a sub, but I really appreciate it when you can get a sub early enough that I'm not available. You know, you just, how to be welcoming and yet remind them of whatever policy you have. My policy was, you don't call me on Saturday night. You just don't. I won't answer the phone. And please get your subbing and everything done by Thursday morning so that I can plan through that. Good job. Thank you, Karina. And I'm so sorry we don't get to hear your wisdom. And last is Sam. And Fran, could you mute yourself, please?
My takeaway is the reminder that we have such a wonderfully supportive community when it comes to religious educators. It can frequently get very lonely in what we do. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't have a colleague in the next cubicle like others might. So to have these opportunities to get together and share. And Regina, I want to thank you for opening yourself and feeling safe enough to be vulnerable in a session like this. Where else do we get to do that? To be with like-minded, respectful, loving colleagues. So the reminder that we are not alone is so important. There's always someone to reach out to and talk to.
Mm-hmm. Hear, hear. And Regina, I have had 5 major crying breakdowns in my life, and that, you know, this would be like in front of congregants when I was overwhelmed. And it happens, and it's overwhelming, isn't it? Yes. And so here's a little more from from Karina. She says, honestly, oh, and there's this. Let's turn it up. Honestly, I do like to sub. I enjoy spending time with the kids so much, but it's not a good precedent. People will just think that's my role all the time. That's, yes. Yep. Yep. So any last little things that you'd like to share before I do a closing? Let me just see where we are. Yeah, Fran.
I have a joy that I'm reading about what the RE committee is supposed to be doing. And I'm happy to know that people want to do what they're called to do. But sometimes I feel that the word director is really misnamed, because it seems to me that nobody is asking me for direction, nor will they be very open to any of the ideas that I have. I'm just saying that this is my experience. This committee that I have, I feel like they are four steamrollers, and I just have to get out of their way. Mm-hmm. And especially, I just had a calling out because I've been sick, and they found out that things were not being done the way they wanted them to be done with regards to the registration and the roster, and that I am just to be there to register people. I'm a teacher, and I'm a kinesthetic teacher. I want to see the kids learn how to be in silence. I don't see it at all. It drives me nuts, crazy nuts. They don't have them doing any Tai Chi. They're not sitting. They're not doing any kind of reflective practice, in my opinion, at all. And I think that we're ripping them off. I really do. I mean, I just went to a silent retreat myself this weekend. I know the value of this. Children can be exposed. They might not be clamoring to come in and sit still. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean that we never or hardly ever offer that. So I have a fire in my belly about that. But also I'm recognizing how to find my balance before I speak, because I know that when I was spoken to, it was with a lot of passion, and I felt slapped around.
Yeah.
Very strongly slapped around. Yeah. And I don't want that anymore. And I'm going to learn, I'm going to take it in as something good. I'm going to learn to set my boundaries. So I think that when you said you want a RE committee, I was going to say, can I send you mine? And I will pray for you, darling. I will really pray for you. But maybe I'm just supposed to stand there like the crossing guard and just put the coat on and just smile. I mean, anyway.
Yeah.
It's because I come from a teaching background and I'm kinesthetic. So I find that when they're just talking, and there's no classroom management at all, I'm ready to jump off the cliff.
Yeah. Thank you, Fran. Yep. Yep. Oh my, yes. It's always a learning experience, isn't it? Oh, yes, yes, yes. Well, and Regina, thank you for sharing that. She said to her volunteers, she's willing to teach 2 Sundays on a 4-Sunday month and 3 Sundays on a 5-Sunday month. And if you're clear, then they can be clear. It's just hard sometimes, I know, to do the big picture stuff. And when I found myself teaching, because we had a fourth and fifth grade class that, I mean, the parents were involved with the church. One was a treasurer, one was a board president, but they couldn't teach. And I found myself teaching. It was my minister, who was my boss, who said, but Katie, you're not doing your job when you teach your big picture. But that was with a larger congregation, Regina. So with a smaller congregation, you are the teacher, aren't you? And the children are probably benefiting a lot from that. So there isn't one panacea for solving all these volunteer problems, is there? Well, in closing, besides holding you all in my hearts and us holding each other in our hearts, I'm going to read the words in the final welcome. As you guide and companion your community of children this month, we hope you connect with the adventure of integrity. When we take the path of curiosity or honesty, there is deep joy in reconnecting with your deepest and truest selves. May that joy be yours as you travel through both December and January and start the new year.